Good evening, everyone, and welcome to our June meeting. Just a word of explanation, President Coleman had a business opportunity, or not actually a requirement, that she be gone tonight. So I'm Mary Snyder. I'm the vice president, so I will be conducting tonight's meeting. Just word of explanation. This is a regular meeting of the School Board of Kenosha Unified School District Number 1. Notice of this regular meeting was given to the public by forwarding the complete agenda to all requesting radio stations and newspapers. Copies of the complete agenda are available for inspection at all public schools and at the superintendent's office. Anyone desiring information as to forthcoming meetings should contact the superintendent's office. I'd ask you to stand with me and recite the Pledge of Allegiance. Stacy, could we have a roll call of board members, please?
Ms. Stevens?
Yes.
Mrs. Snyder?
Yes.
Mr. Koenig?
Yes.
Mr. Garcia?
Yes.
Mr. Falkowski?
Here.
Mr. Wade?
Here.
Mrs. Coleman?
Okay, next on the agenda are awards and recognition. Dr. Savaglio Jarvis.
Thank you, Madam President, members of the board. This evening we have a group with us, and Ms. Reuter will introduce them, and we'll celebrate their winnings.
Good evening. Tonight we have just one group with us, the Brompton Archery Team. Please come on in. Okay. The Brompton Archery Team is with us tonight because they earned third place in the National Archery in the School's Program State Archery Tournament held in Wisconsin. In the Wisconsin Dells in April. The team includes Hannah Cleland, Paige Norton, Brooke Schmidt, Peyton Weathersby, Nikolai DeFord, Haley Weathersby, Olivia Nashtigal, Ala Ahmed, Michaela McConville, Sophie Castro, Tony Lating, and Paula Durthy. In addition to the third place team award, Sophie Castro earned first place in the third grade girls division 3D IBO competition and third place in the third grade girls division bullseye competition. Hannah Cleland earned first place in the fourth grade girls division 3D IBO competition and third place in the third grade girls division bullseye competition. Peyton Weathersby earned second place in the fourth grade girls division 3D IBO competition. Tony Lating earned third place in the fourth grade boys division 3D IBO competition. And Zachary Hoffmeyer earned the Bullseye Award, which is given to an individual who has made notable positive strides in academic performance and behavior through their involvement in the program. Last, Scott Cleland, the parent organizer for the Brompton Archery Team, earned the National NASP Superhero Award, which was presented to him at the NASP National Competition in Louisville, Kentucky on May 14th, 2016. This award is intended to recognize an unpaid volunteer who makes an outstanding positive impact on the NASP program or team. Congratulations to everyone on your wonderful achievements. We're very proud of you.
Next on the agenda, the administrative and supervisory appointments. Dr. Savaglio Jarvis.
Thank you, Madam President, members of the board. We have several this evening, so I will do them in alphabetical order. I will call our recommendation candidate up, and I will read their bio, and then we'll wait for the vote and the approval, and then our candidate will come through to be congratulated. So our first up, we have Kim Fisher. She is our internal regional coordinator of leadership and learning for our secondary schools. Kim Fisher has been working in education since 1998. Her degrees include a Bachelor of Arts in English from the University of Wisconsin Parkside and a Master of Science in Educational Leadership from Cardinal Stritch. Her current certifications include teacher, principal, director of instruction, and administrator. Ms. Fisher began her career as a teacher at McKinley Middle School in 1998. She then moved to Mahone Middle School in 2002 before becoming the assistant principal at Bullen Middle School shortly after. In 2007, she accepted the role of principal at Bullen Middle School, where she remained until she took on her current role as assistant principal at Bradford High School in 2013. During her time as a building leader, she coordinated and led building-level professional development, renewed the Freshman Academy, implemented Quest, implemented the team leadership course, planned and led annual data retreats, and much more. Ms. Fisher's extensive knowledge and planning and implementation skills are a great fit for this interim role in Kenosha Unified. Her broad experience in a variety of educational areas will allow her to provide guidance and leadership to others in our district. So my recommendation is Kim Fisher for the interim regional coordinator of leadership and learning secondary.
I'd like to make a motion to accept administration's recommendation.
Second.
Motion's been made and seconded. All those in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Any opposed? Congratulations, Kim.
Let's go keep smiling. Congratulations.
Our second recommendation this evening is Scott Kennel. Would Scott come forward? Scott Kennel has been working in education since 1996. His degrees include a Bachelor of Science in Education from the University of Wisconsin Oshkosh and a Master of Arts in Educational Leadership from Cardinal Stritch. His current certifications include teacher, principal, director of instruction, and administrator. Mr. Kennel began his career with the Green Meadow Elementary School in Oshkosh Area School District in 1996, where as a fifth grade teacher. From there, he took on a role as a seventh grade math teacher in Kenosha Unified's McKinley Middle School in 1998 before doing a short stint as the assistant principals of Central High School from 2000 to 2004. He then returned to Kenosha Unified in 2004, where he taught at Frank Elementary until becoming the principal of Edward Baines School of Language and Art in 2006. In 2010, he moved to Brass Community School, and in 2015, he became principal of Summers Elementary. Along the way, Mr. Kennel worked to increase graduation rates, stabilize the dual language program, increase student achievement, implemented professional learning communities, led implementation of a school-wide behavioral systems, and much more. In addition, colleagues named him the 2012-2013 Administrator of the Year. His varied experience has allowed him to develop and grow throughout the years, making him a great fit for this new role in Kenosha Unified. So it's my pleasure to recommend Scott Kennel for the Regional Coordinator of Leadership and Learning and Elementary.
Motion to accept administration's recommendation.
All right, it's been moved and seconded to accept this recommendation. All those in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Any opposed? Okay, welcome, Scott.
My next recommendation is Cheryl Colthy. Would you please come forward? This is for our Coordinator of Career and Technical Education. Cheryl Colthy has been working in education since 1987. Her degrees include a Bachelor of Science in Marketing Education from the University of Wisconsin Stout and a Master's of Arts in Teaching from Aurora University. She also holds a certificate as a Career and Technical Education Coordinator from the University of Wisconsin Stout. Her current certifications include teacher, administrator, and career and technical education coordinator. Ms. Colthy began her career with Racine Unified as a marketing education teacher in 1987. She spent many years in this role and served in a variety of capacities, including deck advisor and marketing internship coordinator. In 2000, she took a new role as a marketing educator and career and technical education coordinator for Wilmot Union High School. In this recent role, she did a number of things, including developing and administering the Carl Perkins Grant, leading an internship program for over 500 students, growing the work-based program opportunities from zero to 350, serving as a liaison between businesses and the district, and assisting with annual budget development, leading professional development for staff and administrators, and again, much, much more. In addition to her work duties, Ms. Colthy also served as an adjunct university instructor for the Universities of Wisconsin, Parkside, and Stout. Her dedication and commitment to the field of career and tech education make her a great fit for the coordinator of career and technical education here in Kenosha. That's a lot of technical education career things. We just usually call it CTE. Her experience and knowledge will be a great asset to Kenosha Unified's program. Welcome, Cheryl. So that's my recommendation for our career and technical education coordinator.
May I have a motion?
I'll second.
All right, motion's been made to approve, made and seconded. All those in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Any opposed? Hey, welcome, Cheryl.
Almost tongue twisting. Congratulations.
And now I'd like to call up Marty Pitts for another recommendation, a regional coordinator of leadership and learning elementary. Marty Pitts has been working in education since 1990. His degrees include a Bachelor of Arts in Education from Carthage College and a Master of Arts in Teaching from National Lewis University. He holds a certificate advanced study from the National Lewis University. His current certifications include teacher, principal, director of instruction, and administrator. Mr. Pitts began his career as a fifth and sixth grade teacher at Frank Elementary School. From there, he became the assistant principal of middle school in 1998. While there, he assisted in leading the transition from junior high to middle school. In 2000, he accepted the role of principal at Whittier Elementary School. It was here that he led staff through understanding the importance of student performance data. In 2007, he became the principal of Nash Elementary School, where he has remained until now. During this time, he oversaw the planning, development, and implementation of an innovative instructional program known as the Next Generation Personalized Learning Model. Through his various roles and responsibilities, Mr. Pitts has gained the knowledge and experience necessary to help move the school leadership team forward. His background with implementing new programs and understanding of performance data will help him to guide others on their journey of providing high-quality education to the students of Kenosha Unified. So it's my pleasure to recommend Mr. Pitts for our Regional Coordinator of Leadership and Learning Elementary.
Motion to accept the administration's recommendation.
Second.
Okay, it's been moved and seconded to accept the recommendation. All those in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Any opposed? Okay, welcome, Marty.
And last but definitely not least, unfortunately, Ms. Rudiker could not be here this evening, but I'd like to recommend her as our coordinator of special education and student support. Lisa Rudiker has been working in education since 1993. Her degrees include a Bachelor and Master of Science from Longwood University. She also holds a certificate in educational leadership from Marion University. Her current certifications include teacher and administrator. Ms. Rudiker began her career in education as a special education teacher in Chesterfield, Virginia in 1993. Her career with Kenosha Unified began when she took on her role as a special education teacher at McKinley Elementary School in 1996, where she taught students in first through fifth grade. In 2001, she accepted a position as a program support teacher for the district. During this time, she provided leadership for the special education program, consulted with teachers and principals, coordinated staff development, assisted with making data-driven decisions, and assisted new teachers and performed many, many other duties. Ms. Rudiker's knowledge and experience in the classroom and working firsthand with families will lend well to her new role as coordinator of special education and student support for Kenosha Unified. And like I said, unfortunately, Lisa could not be here this evening, but that's my recommendation for special coordinator of special education student support.
I'd like to make a motion to accept administration's recommendation for Lisa Rudiker.
Okay, motion has been made and seconded to accept the administration recommendation. All those in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Any opposed? Okay, thank you very much, and we will meet and greet her at a later time. Thank you, Dr. Next item on the agenda is the legislative report, and we don't have one this evening, so we'll move forward and going to the views and comments by the public, and I have a statement to read. Welcome to all those who've signed up to speak to the board tonight. We would like to remind you school board meetings are not public meetings, but official business meetings held in public. Board meetings are conducted for the purpose of carrying the business of the district. Even so, the boards established this opportunity to hear public input on district issues through guidelines set out in school board policy and rule 8870, titled Public Participation at School Board Meetings. This policy allows citizens an opportunity to make comments during the views and comments by the public portion of regular school board meetings. Speakers are limited to 3 minutes, and comments may deal with any topic related to district issues or concern and/or the board's agenda. However, in public session, the board shall not hear irrelevant, repetitive, abusive, or harassing speech or speech that causes disruption to the orderly conduct of the meeting. The board shall also not hear discussion of confidential personnel disputes or grievances involving individual school employees that do not implicate issues of public concern or individual student disciplinary matters. There are other channels available in the district that provide for consideration and disposition of such matters. Although we may not respond to every comment tonight and may only deal with published agenda items as stated in Wisconsin Open Meetings Law, your concern will be recorded and forwarded to the appropriate staff. As you approach the microphone, please state your name and address. Again, welcome to each of tonight's speakers. Our board secretary, Stacey Busby, will keep the time, and we'll begin. And the first listing on the sheet is the WIA watchdog representative. So if you'll give a name and address, and then we'll proceed. Thank you.
Okay, before I start, according to policy 8712, a copy of the complete agenda shall be available for all public inspection at the superintendent's of schools office and each building in principal's office prior to the board meeting. I called several schools and not one school had a copy available. So somebody here is in violation of policy 8712. Also, rule 8870 states, the board president or other presiding officer may honor a request to permit a speaker more time than provided for good reasons. Okay, I am respectfully requesting more time, maybe only a minute or two. The reason why, we've timed other people at the podium and they spoke longer than 3 minutes and they never properly followed the rule of 8870, and I'm just asking to be treated like everybody else. Also, I didn't come to the board meeting when there are issues about the bathroom deal. I didn't want to come during that time because I didn't want to take up anyone else's time because that was that was going on at the time. Anyhow, so I'm respectfully asking what many other citizens got as an extra minute or so.
I think an extra minute looking at agenda would be sufficient. So Stacy, 4 minutes, that's fine. Thank you.
Okay, tell me when it starts. Tell me when you're starting the clock.
It started when you started speaking.
No.
Yeah.
Well, you didn't tell me that. I said before I start. Well, then I asked for an extra minute because what I came here for was not, I mean, you guys, I'm pointing this out that you violated. Also, it does not say in here that the people have to give their name and address according to a rule, and a rule supersedes the policy. So I'm going to ask for an extra minute because you guys didn't follow your policy.
We'll see how long it goes.
Okay. So, in January, I received a phone call from the WI representative who represents Kenosha Unified School. We discussed violations, student-athlete safety issues, and other things throughout the state. You may know his name, it's Steve Connect. He confirmed that the Kenosha Unified School District was violating WIA policies.
I'm sorry, we've asked you, the statement reads, please do not discuss specific personnel issues.
No,
okay, if you
me,
have information
stating,
you want to share.
I'm stating, ma'am, this is not a personnel, I'm stating who the representative is for the WIA. That he is, I'm not talking about if he's an employee or anything. I'm letting the public know who the representative is.
But he is an employee.
I will also like to share with you the Bill of Rights of the United States Constitution and most about the First Amendment. This is a public facilities that receives state and federal money. You can't tell me what I can or cannot say without violation of my constitutional protection. So I would like to speak without interruption.
I'm sorry, that's not accurate. This is a public business meeting of a school board, and we do have rules and policies here. And we will ask you to abide those rules and policies.
Ma'am, it's not in here, written in Rule 8770. It is not written in there, which supersedes your policy.
How much time are we at, Stacy?
No. Yeah.
I'm done, sir. This is harassment and stalking.
No.
I'm done with your time.
No,
you're out of order.
If you have an issue, would like to say.
I have an issue, and I get to speak. That's part of your policy.
But you haven't gotten there yet.
Your policy.
And we're saying you've used up your time. So if you have an issue.
You're telling me 4 minutes is up?
If you have an issue to get to. You
yes,
may.
Ma'am. Yeah,
otherwise, I'm going to ask you
okay.
to leave.
Can I please do it without interruption? That's all I'm asking.
Not if you're going to talk about personnel. No.
It wasn't personnel. Okay, let's move on. I won't bring up any personnel.
Okay.
Okay. All right. I got to start from the beginning now. I was contacted by a WIA representative who stated that Kenosha Unified is violating the WIA issues. Okay. He told me that I cannot take pictures of student athletes and sell them. I'm a digital artist. He told me he would get back to me, and he never did. I sent out an email on July 21st and asked for a response. He did not respond. I received a letter from an attorney that claims that he is representing Kenosha Unified School District. He never CC'd it to Kenosha Unified. And he never said who that person was. So then the next day, I called a person at Kenosha Unified, and I said, what are the credentials for hiring an attorney? And she wouldn't tell me. And then I asked her another question, and I said, what are you basing that on? And she goes, just because I know. And I said, are you familiar with the core values of Kenosha Unified and the vision statement? She said, no. I said, do you even know where they are? She said, no. That's in violation of Kenosha Unified School District rules. So then I call that attorney's office to ask for his credential license number. Tell me when 15
Four
seconds
minutes.
Is up.
I'm
you
sorry, sir, your time
me,
is up.
Though, and he interrupted me. I'm respectfully asking for another minute.
No, and I'm going to say
twice.
At this point, no, but if you will send your things to me in writing, I will see they will get
you
to the right people.
School board and superintendent,
okay.
And I have the evidence, so
okay.
I think somebody should look at it.
Okay. So if you send it to us, we will.
No, last
Thank you.
Time the
Next speaker on tonight's agenda is Jackie Karabatsis. Jackie?
Good evening. Jacqueline Karabatsis, 2549 80th Place, Kenosha. I'm here tonight to talk about the ban the box item that's on the agenda tonight. I'm not here to necessarily persuade you to ban the box, although I personally do support that movement. But I'm speaking out because it doesn't seem like you're poised to have a fair discussion on the matter. I read through the report and the agenda. It talks about the rising number of workplace violence incidents, stresses the importance of protecting our students, talks about the value of background checks, and that we should not get rid of them, and therefore we should not change our employment application. Well, of course we shouldn't get rid of background checks. No one would agree to that. But ban the box is not about that. It's merely about changing the point in time at which the background check is done. Some do it after the person has been invited to interview. Others do it as a final step before offering employment. The reasons behind ban the box are mainly twofold. One, some qualified applicants are discouraged from even applying when they see that question on the application. They believe they won't be hired if they check that box. Two, many employers have used that box to screen out applicants or put them at the bottom of the list, despite the fact that they're still legally qualified to do the job. It does happen. So the argument is to move the background check further down in the process, schedule the interview, run the check, and have that discussion about the circumstances during the interview. You might find you still have a good fit for the job. It is slightly different with school districts. Than other businesses, because school districts can flat out deny employment to anyone convicted of a felony. One possibility would be to ask solely about felony convictions on the application to screen out applicants, but wait for the background check until the interview stage. Maybe you feel that would be too burdensome. All I hope is that you have a fair discussion about Ban the Box. The discussion is really not about workplace safety or whether or not to conduct a background check. Of course you do a background check. Of course you keep our teachers and students safe. Ban the Box is about the timing of the check. It's about making sure we don't screen out people with misdemeanors or municipal citations before we hear them out to see if there's any legal nexus between their crime and their job duties. And maybe our district doesn't have a problem with that. Maybe we don't screen out applicants who check that box. But I think a fair discussion on this would be to look at those numbers. How many otherwise qualified applicants have checked that box and still received an interview? How many have received an employment offer? I would think a fair discussion would focus on these things, not use scare tactics about workplace violence, because Ban the Box is not about ban the background check. If, after discussing the real issues surrounding Ban the Box, you feel that we should still keep the application as it stands, I would still recommend increasing the size of the explanation box you provide on the application. It's one of the smallest boxes on the application. It provides approximately two lines of text. I'm not sure if there's a character limit when you complete that online, but visually the box is very small and doesn't truly invite an explanation. Thank you.
Thank you very much. And that concludes the people who have signed up to speak tonight. Do we have response and comments from board members? Anyone? Okay, then simple remarks by the president. I will like to thank Jackie because you gave me some things to think about I hadn't thought about before when we start discussing this. I appreciate that, and I appreciate your comments tonight. And again, I will thank President Coleman for giving me this opportunity, even though it was inadvertent and a responsibility she had to fulfill. So saying that, we will move on to the superintendent's report.
Okay. Thank you, Madam President, members of the board. Good evening. I'm so proud to share a number of student successes. First, I'd like to start by congratulating the 1,491 students who crossed the stage during our graduation ceremonies earlier this month, and thank you to all of our board members who participated. I think you also saw the celebration of the learning success, the pride in our children, as well as our parents and grandparents and everybody out there celebrating that, so thank you. It is a wonderful week of celebrations by all Kenosha Unified, where we wished our students well as they head out in the world to develop that next big chapter book of their life. Next, I'd like to applaud all of our staff and students who made our first few weeks of summer school and our summer camps are amazing experiences for all. Everything's been running smoothly and the students are enjoying all that they're experience. We have core academics or STEM-based learning, actually sometimes STEAM, with the arts involved as well. The students of Kenosha are continuing their education and having fun while doing so. Thank you to our staff out there who continue to work with our students even during the summer. We know that you're giving up some wonderful time as well, and we are grateful for that dedication. Lastly, I'd like to congratulate the cast and crews of Dogfight and the elaborate entrance of Chad Deity for their performance at this year's Thespian Festival. We routinely have just a great theater group and the Aquids that come back. The group just returned from performing for hundreds of thespian and troop directors on the festival's main stage in the Chapter Select Showcase, which is, again, a very prestigious event. So highly competitive, very prestigious. And being selected to perform on the main stage is really not an easy accomplishment because of the highly selective judges. They only choose really the best of the best to perform. So I think you have to realize we have some top-notch fine arts programs. So congratulations and well wishes to them. And just want to thank everybody. 4th of July is coming up, so happy 4th of July. And I think somewhere else, don't we all get a day off somewhere? Do we? I don't know. Are we off that day, you guys? Okay, yes. Okay, thank you.
I'll remind you of that you are off.
Oh, no,
day.
You're working? Oh. Oh, okay, thank you.
Say, I want to see no emails. Next on the agenda, the consent agenda. Mr. Wade?
I'd like to make a motion to approve the consent agenda with the addition of the revised personnel report.
Second.
Okay, it's been moved and seconded to accept the consent agenda as amended, revised, including the revised personnel report. Any questions or comments? Anything for discussion? Okay, all those in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? Okay, the ayes have it. Thank you. Then we'll move right away into old business, and this is the adoption of instructional materials for kindergarten through fifth grade social studies. Dr. Savaglio Jarvis.
Thank you, Madam President, members of the board. It is recommended that the Board of Education approve this request to purchase and begin using the kindergarten through fifth grade My World Social Studies series published by Pearson Education for the 2016-17 school year. And Julie is up here as well for any questions or clarity on that.
Mr. Wade.
Motion to approve.
Second.
A motion has been made and seconded. Are there any questions or comments for Julie? Anybody? Oh, I'm sorry. Okay, Mike, yes.
Julie, I just wanted to thank you for the opportunity extended to me to review the material. I mean, I'm not an educator, but I'm a geographer, and I really appreciate it. I got to understand the depth of the material that the students study now and the more interactive environment. It's great that they no longer just use these old textbooks. They actually use something like a workbook. So I think this is going to be great, and I hope this will get more people interested in geography and not thinking of it as just that boring textbook subject. So thank you.
Thank you. Ms. Stevens.
I want to echo what Mr. Falkowski said. I'm glad to see that we're getting this new curriculum and hopefully getting our kids excited at a young age about this. So thank you.
I also want to express my thanks. I really like the idea of a curriculum that is across the district and that gives teachers guidelines to work from. Obviously, it's not a prescription for day-to-day activity, but it is a guideline to ensure that all students in every school have a similar experience with social studies, and I think it's overdue. I'm really happy to see this moving forward. Any other comments or questions?
If I can just say thank you all very much. And while I am sitting in this chair, I really would like to extend that to Mr. Kirby as well as the team of teachers that worked on this, because truly it was their work that's bringing it forward this evening. So thank you all again.
Great. And we all know it works best when the whole staff's involved. We know that. Okay, thank you. Any other questions or comments? All those in favor of the recommendation, please say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Any opposed? Okay, motion passes. Thank you. Next item, the adoption of instructional materials for high school mathematics. Dr. Savaglio Jarvis.
Yep, thank you, Madam President, members of the board. As you can see in a little bit of the background, you all did some approving in 2014, that sixth through eighth grade, in some of those main high school courses. However, at the time, there were some other courses that were not looked at or not offered and purchased since about 2006 for some of those kind of singleton courses. And so, again, Julie and her team have really worked hard at doing some updating. So, again, we're asking for a recommendation that you approve the request to purchase and begin using the following text in 2016-2017. And you can see on page 51 the text, the publisher, and the course. And Julie is up here as well if there's any additional questions or anything Julie would like to add.
Okay, questions or comments? Are we ready for a motion? Okay, Mr. Wade.
Motion to approve the instructional materials for high school mathematics.
I'll second it.
Okay, been moved and seconded to approve this recommendation. Any questions or comments? Anybody? Again, I think these are good additions too. We've got a good additions and expanding the reach and expanding the choices for our students. So thank you. Thank you. Motion on the floor. All those in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Any opposed? Thank you very much. Thank you, Mrs. Hausman, for your information. Oh, you're still here.
Yep, okay. Julie's going to stay.
Then we move into new business. This is a discussion action item, reports of contracts and aggregate of $25,000.
Motion to accept.
I'll second that.
Okay, been moved and seconded to accept this report. Any questions or discussion? All those in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Aye. Any opposed? Okay, motion passes. Thank you. Next item on the agenda, discussion action of the school year 2017-18 instructional calendar. Dr. Savaglio Jarvis.
Okay, thank you, Madam President, members of the board. As you can see, we're already starting to plan for the 2017-2018 school year. Chris and his team did the survey, things that we need to do, and he's going to kind of report back overall what the survey said and then provide you with those calendars. And again, please feel free to ask questions and so you can understand what that vote will be coming up for 17-18 school year.
Any questions or discussion? Or
Chris, do a little overview, because this is a little bit more.
Okay.
I'll do a brief overview, because it's consistent from past years. We did implement a staff survey again, had about just over 1,800 responses. consistent with previous surveys for the staff of the larger majority, two-thirds or so being teacher responses to give us that good instructional feel of where they're at. Most of the responses were pretty consistent with previous surveys, leaving the instructional minute formats for the Monday through Thursday days or the current early release options that we have for elementary, middle, and high school. The only real noticeable change was the staff's strong feeling that switched from winter break having it from a variable 8 to 10 work days off for 2 full weeks at a max to now switching to the recommendation to move that to 2 full weeks, so that's represented in the calendars. These all still represent 3 potential canceled snow days in them when we cover those days. As far as the calendar themselves, it unfortunately, September 1st is a Friday, so we made the decision not to start school on a Friday, just to have elementary kids come for a half a day and then be off for the Labor Day weekend and adjust in that scenario. So between a later start of the year and the 2 full weeks, it does push the end of the year to mid-June in that as represented. And we'll certainly update the high school calendar once the state communicates the defined contracted ACT and work keys days.
Okay, questions or comments?
I'd like to make a motion to accept administration's recommendation on the calendar.
Second. Okay, motion's been made and seconded to accept that recommendation. Any other discussion or questions? Okay, all those in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Any opposed? No, motion passes. Thank you. Thank you. Next item for discussion, questions regarding the prior pending misdemeanor and or felony charges on an employment application. And, of course, that's the box issue that was discussed earlier. Dr. Sabaglo-Jarvis.
Yep, Madam President, you have your report. Basically, this is an informational item that at one point at the board meeting it said you'd like to come back and just have a little discussion around it. So Ms. Petering, our Chief of Human Resource Officer, will be up as well to for questions or clarity and guidance. So informational and discussion.
Hey, Mrs. Stevens.
Yes, I was just hoping that you could, I don't know if you took notes on Jackie when she spoke, but she made a lot of different points, and just maybe if you could speak to those for clarification purposes. And
yes, I think the main two points, the main issues that I was able to glean from Jackie's statement was the timing of the criminal background check. You know, while I do understand the idea behind this ban the box movement, based on the type of employer that we are as an educational employer and the needs that we have as it is, you know, when hiring time comes, it's hard for us to get through that process. So in order for us to make that investment in the interview, in identifying that candidate, and then to put that criminal background check at the very last, as the very last thing that we do, you know, I do think that would be putting an additional burden on our process.
Yes, follow up.
Just looking at the timing and everything, so it could go either way, it seems like. But I guess, how do we currently screen? Like if somebody has a misdemeanor or something like that, do you have any data on that?
You know, actually, we don't have a way, based on the size of our district, to track every single employee. I can tell you off the top of my head, we do have 2 individuals in the district who have background. So, you know, the discussion is that substantial relationship, that substantial nexus. So we have the screening process, although in Wisconsin it does give us that freedom to have that discussion. We are still cognizant of federal guidelines, which is, you know, you cannot discriminate based on a person's past conviction record. So we are mindful of that. It is a balancing test, and we do have that discussion with individuals.
It's just the last one would be, is if you go online and you fill out that application, does it allow more than just the space?
You know,
there?
That's a very good question, and I did make
it.
A note, and I do want to thank Ms. Karabetsos for bringing that up, and I will look into that. I was not aware of that, so thank you.
Yeah.
So I have that noted, and we can find that out.
Okay.
Thank you.
Mr. Koenig.
I too, tend to agree with what Rebecca said and Jackie said. I mean, I think, you know, if somebody is going to be forced into checking that box, that we need to give them adequate space to do that. So I do appreciate that. But I have to agree with you on that also, and respectfully disagree with you, Jackie, that, you know, I know that just in my job alone, we advertised a job. We had over 100 applicants for the job. And, you know, it has to go through. They do background checks extensively to see if they meet the requirements on that. And then I might get 13 to 15 people who actually pass all those hoops through those hoops. I don't have time to interview 15 people either. I have to get a committee together to do a resume review to get it down to 5, and then another group together to do those interviews to interview those 5 people. And that entire process can take over a month to get from when the job closes to when we're doing that. So, and I think it is imperative that we do that criminal background check as soon as possible, because of the timeliness, but also because I do believe we have we must do everything we can to protect our students and our teachers. And, you know, I understand where this is going to hurt people or they'll feel uncomfortable, but in this day and age, we must take every precaution possible to protect those schools. And even if we take every precaution possible, we know that somebody who wants to do something is still going to find a way. But I don't want to be one of the people sitting up here on this board that makes a decision that made it easier for somebody to do that. I could not live with myself knowing that we did something that allowed something to happen, and that's why I support the way we're going. But I do would like to see us give those employees an opportunity to expound on their resume.
Okay. Mr. Falkowski.
Just some clarification. We had a lot of information about violence in the workplace and why it's important as a district to protect ourselves by not letting, you know, a violent person do something. What part of the hiring process is our check for that? To help keep, you know, violent person out of the, or person that might hurt the people out from being hired by the district. What part of the process is involved with that, is the check on that? Like, you know, say like if someone didn't check the box at all.
Well, okay, so we have the criminal background check process. So right. If someone comes back domestic battery or some other sort of violent offense, now, if someone fails to check the box and then we go through and hire them, then that's a falsification of employment issue, and that could be a terminable offense.
So if they didn't check the box, you might not do a background check?
No, we would do a background check regardless.
So the fault would be on the background check, not digging up in the background check?
I don't understand your question. Can you...
I'm trying to understand the process, so maybe that's why I'm not asking it right. When someone applies, right, regardless of the check the box, you do a background check. Do you do a criminal background check?
Yes, we do a criminal background check on every employee.
All right, so the fault in the process then would not be the box, it's the background check. Someone missed something in the background check. If someone got through, if the box wasn't checked and somebody was hired by the district. I mean, even regardless if you found out later, right, they falsified, but the issue would be with the background check. I guess where I'm getting to is I don't see where this box does anything, actually.
Well, actually, the box does hold an individual accountable to being truthful.
Okay. But they would still, even without the box, if you ask them about, if you dug those records up and asked them about it, they would still have to be truthful about it.
Right, but it you know, but that... As an educational employer, can you imagine we hire a teacher and then we come to find out that teacher has, a laden past, and there was never a discussion, never an honest conversation with us at the beginning, and it's only after we get this background check that we have to pull this person out and say, hey, what is this about?
So you would do the background check after you hired him?
No, the background check is done right in the very beginning. What I'm saying is, you know, if the box is marked and that map, do you understand what I'm saying?
Yeah.
So the discrepancy may not be caught until further down the process.
Okay, so you want the box just to try to force people to be honest with what they have to start that discussion at the front?
The box is a part of the employment application, and there is right below the box, you know, there is an opportunity for the candidate to provide an explanation. And, you know, I think earlier in March, one of our HR coordinators, Roddy Dmitrievich, may have come forward and spoken about that process where we do, the HR coordinators do have conversations with individuals if they do have the box marked. People do actually get a fair shake. This is not an automatic you're out, unless obviously the individual is a sexual predator. I mean, we have to have some scruples here. We are an educational employer.
Well,
I mean, it's a balancing interest. It is a balancing test. We are not Jimmy John's. It is a balancing test in the interest of the safety of our students and staff versus the individual interest of a person seeking employment. I get that, but I also get that we are all charged here with the safety of our students and staff.
I'm going to call on Mr. Wade because he hasn't spoken yet, but I also see Mrs. Stevens and Mr. Kunick have lights on. Mr. Wade?
Yeah, I was just curious. Now, if somebody does check the box and it does say here, convicted of any felony, misdemeanor, or other offense, is that the way it appears on the application?
What's in our agenda?
Give me one second. I'm trying to find the...
I think there's a sample on our agenda, if you want to...
Right.
Yes, yes, that's
correct. I'm just making sure that I'm reading it right.
Okay.
Yes, you are.
Okay.
And so, then the next box with, do you have any pending
right.
criminal charges?
Now, if they check that box, they can still go on with an explanation, of course?
Yes.
Even with a felony?
Well, we do give them the opportunity to provide an explanation because it could be that this is something from 15 years back.
Well, the issue I've got is with the term other offense. You know, I mean, that could be a parking ticket. That could be a... you name it. You know, I do not have any problem whatsoever with Class A misdemeanors and felonies, mm-hmm. you know, unless pardoned. That's the way it was in law enforcement. You could apply. If you were convicted of a felony and you were pardoned, mm-hmm. then you're okay. Convicted of a felony, find a different career. But I just wanted to make sure in my mind what the other offense, what that particularly meant. In your opinion, I'm not asking you to give me a definitive answer on that, but
and it could be something like that. Again, that's where you have the box where you know they can provide an explanation.
Okay, that's fair.
Hey, Mrs. Stevens.
First of all, I'd just like to clarify. I don't think anybody here is, for one moment, saying we shouldn't have background checks as well as sexual predator background
sure.
checks. I mean, those are a given, and they are given in just about every business these days, and for volunteers, everything. I think the opportunity to explain why, and I do mm-hmm. agree with Mike in the simple fact that if we're doing our background checks mm-hmm. and we're doing our due diligence to make sure this employee is screened to the level at which Kenosha Unified expects us to do, mm-hmm. The box is really, it doesn't matter. The one thing it does do is it gives that person an opportunity to explain themselves. So, and I would think if I'm going to apply for a job and I would explain myself as well, I've had to, not for misdemeanors or felonies or things like that, but when you have a bankruptcy per se, people look at you in a different view and you have to explain yourself.
Mm-hmm.
And so that's not on a box, on a resume, but if somebody gets a background check or looks me up, you're going to find that, and I'm going to say, yes, that happened to me. and I'm going to explain it. So I agree that what Mr. Falkowski and I think Jackie are trying to get at is, if we're doing our due diligence, we don't have to worry about if a sexual predator has a record, it should come up. Mm-hmm. So, and I don't think that someone applying is going to necessarily check a box and say, you know, I'm applying for a job to work with children, I'm a sexual predator. So I think that's a poor example, and that is not what we're getting at here. We're looking at the simple fact that if somebody does have a misdemeanor or another issue, but yet they have the proper qualifications and they've taken care of that issue, we don't want to turn good candidates away from that point of view either. So I think that's the whole point of the discussion, at least from my point of view. And I definitely want to keep the very best and highest quality teachers and staff and volunteers mm-hmm. in our schools, because everyone should feel safe. So I think that's the whole idea of the discussion. And I think it's very important to have those discussions, because discrimination comes in many forms and fashions. And I can tell you that I've been discriminated against based on what I just shared with you. And that does have an overall impact in your ability to make a living. So I think that we have to consider those things and think broader. And a misdemeanor or a felony that's been many, many years ago, is depending on what that felony is, I know that the school district has made those judgments in the past. So I think we're in good hands there, and I don't think the box is going to change that either way. So I think anybody that applies for a job and they're honest and upfront, they're going to share if they have something that happened to them as well. So thank you.
Mr. Kunick.
I was just going to add, I mean, to Mike's point there, you know, how, you know, does a background check should pick something up? I can tell you from a personal hiring experience where I had to hire someone, if somebody changes their name, in theory, that should come up in a background check. But if they do it well enough, it does not come up in a background check. At least it didn't during a particular hiring process. And so there was actually somebody who had some legal issues that even our background check didn't pick it up. And so, not here at KUSD, for clarification. Sorry, I saw Sue all of a sudden just say, what the? No. So, I mean, I see why that's an additional, I understand the additional step in there, and I understand that. So, and I believe you when you said it in the presentations that this has not banned people from getting employed here. So, and I trust you on that. So thank you.
Any other questions or discussion? Did you have your light on again? Mr. Wade.
First of all, I agree with Annie. It does give a person the opportunity to check the box and say yes, but it also gives them the opportunity to avoid. And if we ultimately find out that, yes, they were convicted of a felony or a Class A misdemeanor, now we have a reason to question them further, and you have to question their honesty. When it deals with sexual predators, the obvious sexual predators will come up on a background check. Class A felonies, Class B felonies, whatever the case may be. What we will not find on your background check are the potential child predators. There's nothing other than a psychological exam that will even give us a clue on who the next sexual predator is going to be. The obvious ones, yeah, not a problem. But unless you take a look at the background check and see what the misdemeanors were, what the municipal ordinance violations were, you know, maybe that'll give you some kind of guidance. But you'd almost need somebody with a crystal ball to determine who the next sexual predator is going to be.
Okay, thank you. Anyone else who hasn't spoken want to contribute? Thank you, Ms. Petering, for your information and for a discussion, and thank you, board members, for the ideas that you've brought forward, and we will continue this. So.
Thank you, and I just want to clarify, I was not making any sort of intimation that...
Oh, no.
Okay, I no. just...
I don't think that was okay. taken. Thank you.
No. All right, thank you.
We will move on then to item D, discussion action, phase two energy efficiency projects, performance contractor selection. Dr. Savaglio Jarvis.
Thank you, Madam President, members of the board. Administration recommends the approval for the performance contractor selection of Nexus Solutions for projects one and two, and McKinstry Ascension for project three. And of course, Patrick is here for the next several items. So we'll allow Patrick to maybe share some information and ask for any questions.
Yeah, really, I'm here to answer questions. Obviously, we all know these projects quite well. We did go through a competitive process. In your report, there's a brief summary, and then also a large attachment that shows our bid evaluation. We made our decision based off of fees, the firm with the lowest fee was awarded two projects. The firm with the second lowest fee was awarded the third project, and they were required to match the fee of the first firm. So with that, I guess I'm here to answer any questions.
Okay, are there any questions? Anybody? Mr. Polkowski.
I would just like to say for all those parents and students who've been waiting for air conditioning, it's coming. We got the two middle schools coming soon, and then the high school's coming after that. Yep.
Yeah, I was happy to share that at graduations. People were happy to hear that. Other discussions? Yeah. All right.
I'll second it.
All right. Motion been made and seconded to approve the recommendation. Any other discussion or question?
Thank you. Thanks to all of you.
Thank you. Okay, all those in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Any opposed? Motion passes. Thank you. Next item D, resolution authorizing the sale of 28,495,000 general obligation school improvement bonds, series 2016.
We'll just turn all that over to Tara, because that's okay. a lot of money. And
thank you, sir.
Hi, Michelle. I see you're here as well, so welcome.
Well, that's a lot of money.
Thank you.
What's that? Why are you going to jail?
What's that? I know. It's a lot
you
of money.
Me?
Okay. So, same project, continuation of the last agenda item. The board has approved the project. The board has now selected the performance contractors. Now we need the money to do this thing.
Now we have to pay them.
So, Michelle Weiberg, Vice President PMA, is here to fill you in on the details of what happened earlier this morning on our bond sale.
Great. Thank you. Good evening. TARC just handed out the presentation that I will just go through briefly. I'm happy to answer any questions that you may have. We start with an interest rate graph, which I think we looked at this last time we met and talked about just setting up this issue as well as the projects that are still forthcoming. But this interest rate chart gives us a 10-year history of the 20-year bond index. So it's essentially the index for AAA-rated municipal bonds that have a 20-year maturity. Prior to this week, the low point in this index was hit in 2012, and we've been tracking this index for over 20 years, since 1994. We have breached that low point just recently. So I'm sure you're all aware of the Brexit vote last week, the UK kind of surprise vote to leave the European Union sent markets into really a tailspin. So on the equity side, on the stock market, not good news at all. I encourage you maybe not to look at your 401k or 403b balances for some time. However, on the flip side, interest rates really rallied over the past 3 or 4 days. So your timing is amazing. You obviously must have known what was going to happen last Thursday evening and entered the market today at a historical low point. So that is great news. As we go into the bids that were received this morning, and we did have a login for Mr. Hamden to watch the bid, so it was a pretty exciting 2 or 3 minutes of his day. We use a bidding platform called Muni Auction, and we use the same platform for your referendum bonds last year. You may recall with this platform, a bidder can put in a bid and they can keep improving their bid until the bid expiration time in an effort to achieve and maintain first place. JP Morgan put in the lowest bid today, and nobody was able to get any lower than JP Morgan. We had 4 bidders submit a total of 13 bids this morning. What I find interesting about this is not only the interest rate, which is absolutely phenomenal at a 2.54%, but also you are continuing to attract really large firms. You go really beyond the normal regional names that we see with a JP Morgan. Last year, your referendum bonds were won by Bank of America. So I think the name as well as the good credit rating are attracting some larger firms to your bond issues in the marketplace and very attractive interest rates as well. With that, I will go into the issue structure itself. And this really fills in the pertinent blanks of the draft resolution that was in your packet. The final par amount of $28,495,000. This is to finance energy efficiency projects. Project one of phase two, you have projects two and three yet to come. The dated or delivery date will be July 26. That's when funds will be available. Principal payment dates are April 1 of 2017 through 23, and then again 2026 through 36. 2026 through 36 maturities are callable or eligible for prepayment in 2025. If we find ourselves in a lower interest rate environment than we are today, I don't want to know why that rationale would be. I can't imagine being in a lower interest rate environment. However, you do have prepayment flexibility even if you have extra funds on hand to do so. Your Moody's rating was affirmed as a AA3. I have to say, really all positive news coming out of Moody's. If you recall, you were upgraded just a year ago. I think they still kind of have your eye on you. There's definitely pressure to go up, not down, which is great. It's just going to be maybe some more years of these surpluses that you're finding and the strong financial management that you have in the district. Enrollment stabilizing would be nice. The strong economy is great. So those are some of the things that they look at. But a great conversation with Moody's. And again, we kind of just keep pushing them every time we talk to them to make sure they are looking at all the positives and maybe pushing you upwards to that next credit rating category. I think it will happen someday. It just might be a couple more years. So keep that in mind. Winning bidder again was JP Morgan at a winning true interest cost of 2.54%. They are responsible for all cost of issuance, so that interest rate is really an all-inclusive rate. We estimated 3.5% when we looked at this just a couple months ago. We knew we were conservative. Never would have dreamed we were 100 basis points conservative. And again, a lot of that movement happened really in the last two or three days. We've gone down probably 25 to 30 basis points just in a few days. So the next page is just the detailed financing plan for this first project. We have your existing debt service that you levy for outside of revenue limits in the first column. We then have this issue, the $28,495,000. We have the offset of your state aid, which is about 35%, or 35 cents of every dollar is comes to you back in state aid. We have a reoffering premium, which the bidder bid a premium today. They bid above par. We're going to use that premium right away to pay off principal. So we increase the first year principal payment accordingly. So you're making a pretty large principal payment right away in 2017, which is great. We work our way over to the right-hand side where we can see your levy when we include this new issue. We keep your levy stable as where it is today of $13.4 million for a couple years. And then we have a breakpoint in it making room for projects two and three, which are on the following page, kind of modeled out for you again. The first project being final at this point, projects two and three being estimates. Very conservative on interest rates there. You can see for the 2018 issue, we're using a 4.5%. For the 2020 issue, a 5.5%. So I think we're good there in terms of being conservative and making sure that we'll just fill in the drop that we've now created a couple years down the road and to not have an increase in the overall levy, even once projects two and three are brought online.
Are there questions
motion
or comments?
Motion to approve.
All right, motion to approve. Is there a second? Okay, it's been moved and seconded to approve the request, administration request. Any other discussion or questions for Michelle or Tarek? Anything?
Thanks.
Oh,
thank
yeah.
You.
Yes. Yeah. Time you got to bring good news.
Time is everything, yes.
Thank you,
thank
yes.
You.
Okay, all those in favor, please say aye.
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 I'm sorry, Mr. Wade.
I was going to tell her it's like Greek. Never mind.
All right, then we will vote. All those in favor, please say aye.
Aye. Aye.
Any opposed? No. Okay, thank you. Motion passes.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Sorry, Dan. Next item on the agenda, then, the authorization of the 2016-17 expenditures prior to formal adoption of the budget. Dr. Savaglio-Jarvis.
Thank you, Madam President, Member of the Board. This is a recommendation that we have your approval to basically spend money to pay our employees and things like that prior to that formal adoption of the budget. So if you have any questions or concern, TARC is here as well.
Any questions?
I'd like to make a motion to accept administration's recommendation.
I'll second it.
All right, motion's been made and seconded to accept the recommendation. Any discussion or questions? Okay. All those in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? Okay, thank you. Motion passes. The last item on the agenda is discussion action of the donations to the district, and I forgot to ask somebody to read this. So is there somebody who has it on the screen who would like to share our donations?
Oh, I would be happy to
talk. Oh, thank you, Mr. Wade.
Oh, Tony, be my guest.
Absolutely. Mr. Garcia. Thank
Dr.
you.
Dr. Sue might not.
You're off. Nope, you're off. Donations. One more time. Now you're on.
Julie Williams donated $1,014.97 to Bradford Theater Program. This donation is to be used for students' trip to the Nebraska International Thespian Festival. Item two, Brass Community School has received NAMNAS donation of $1,000. This donation is to be used for the stair wrapping with math facts. Is there a motion to
approve?
To approve the donations to the district.
I'll second it.
Second.
Okay, any discussion or other questions? As always, we're very grateful for the people who generously donate to the district. Yeah. All those in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Any opposed? Okay, thank you. Motion passes. And there is no other business as permitted by law, so I will entertain a motion to adjourn.
Motion to adjourn.
Second.
All right. All those in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Aye. I think we have a, well, not quite a record, 8:05. Okay. Thank you.